So in this video, I'm showing about the concept that is swapping. Swapping belongs to the memory management. So in the memory management, why the swapping will be implemented means, the swapping is actually implemented for the functioning of multi-programming system. That means here, whenever we are doing the multi-programming or the multi-processing, we have to allocate the memory locations for each and every process. For the allocation of the process, when we are implementing multi-programming in the main memory, we use the concept called as swapping. And actually, let us go for what is the concept of multi-programming system. So, that means how this multi-programming process will be allocated or stored in the main memory. So, suppose in a multi-programming system, we can store multiple processes in the main memory. Hence, from this main memory, the processes will be transfers to CPU. That means here, the CPU always takes the content from the main memory only. That is, whatever the process will be resides under the main memory, that information will be transfers to the CPU for the execution. The CPU never take the information from the secondary memory. The CPU never takes the information from the, which is placed in the secondary memory. So, for increasing the efficiency or the utilization of the CPU, the processes must and should be stored in the main memory only. Usually, the main memory is divided into two parts. One is operating system part and the second part is user part, user process part. In this user process part, it is divided into different partitions. What are these partitions? Are nothing but the partitions are called as a process. Let us assume that in the user part, the partitions will be divided into process. Here I am taking as in process P1, like that process P2, process P3, process P4 and process P5 up to N. Whatever the process we have to execute currently, so those process will be resides in the main memory of user part. So let us go. So what are the operations will be done by the operating system and next one CPU. Here among these process, mainly the process will be performed two types of operations. Mainly it performs two types of operations. The first operations are CPU operations and the second operations are I/O operations. That means in multi-programming system or in the multi-processing system, the multiple processes execute two types of operations. The first operation is CPU operations. The second operations are I/O operations. Now, the CPU operations means all the operations which are executable by some calculations. That means arithmetical operations, logical operations like that. So, I/O operations means simply read and write operations. Simply read and write operations. These I/O operations will be happened by the user and next one operating system. That means operating system part and user part perform the operations, that is called input-output operation. The input-output operation means input operation means reading, the output operation means writing. Okay. So for performing the input operation, we use the read system call. For performing the output operation, we use write system call. Let us go how the multi-programming system will be evolved between the main memory and next one CPU. So here, let's assume here we are having the number of process will be resides in the main memory. And one thing you have to understand, whatever the process will be presented in the user part of main memory, those process could not be executed directly in the CPU. These process will be executed whenever it contains the variables only. Okay? If these process performs the read and write operation, then those operations could not be performed in the CPU. So, let's in this part I define how the CPU will be busy always. We are saying that always the CPU is in a busy state. How the CPU will be busy, that means Let's see that, for example, let's assume that the process P1 is waiting for an IO operation. You know, IO operation means read and write operation. So then the process P1 request to CPU. The process P1 request to CPU. So, but the CPU, though the CPU is free at this time, okay, whenever the process P1 sends the request to the CPU is in an idle state. But here, what request the process sends to the CPU means it sends the request for performing of IO operation. So, as we know that the CPU could not perform the IO operation, so this request transfers to operating system. This request transfers to operating system. That means here, the process P1 which sends the IO request, that initially turns to CPU, but the CPU could not accept this IO request, and this CPU transfers this IO operation to operating system. That means here, the process P1 IO request turns to operating system part, and this operating system performs input output operation. In this meanwhile, the CPU the operating system turns the CPU and by allocating process P2. That means here, when the processes P1 turns its IO operation to OS, this OS allocates the process P2 to CPU. Okay, the process P2 to CPU. In this way, the CPU is busy with the process P2. First, suppose, let us assume that if the process P2 also sending the IO request again to the CPU. Now, this IO request will be handled by the operating system, and this operating system again allocates the process P3 to CPU. In this way, we are saying that while one process will be executing in the CPU is taking another process. This is the word we are coming. Okay? That means whenever it does not perform the IO operation, the CPU is allocated to other process by the operating system. So in this way, always the CPU will be in a busy state. Initially, P1 will be request to the CPU, but the CPU does not accept the process P1 request. Why? Because it turns off IO operation. Hence, this IO operation is performed by the operating system, and this operating system allocates the process P2 to CPU. So when the CPU takes the request of P2, if the request is IO, again the CPU will be allocated for P3, and the P3 will be executed by CPU, and the P2 will be executed by operating system. For suppose if P3 again sends the IO request, again the CPU will be allocated for P4, and this P3 process is executed by operating system. This is the concept how the operating system, how the CPU will be in a busy state. Okay? For executing the operations on CPU, the process must and shouldly resides in the main memory only. That means the CPU takes the contents from the main memory only. That's why the processes request from the CPU. Okay. Now, let us see our actual concept, that is of swapping. How the swapping will be processed. Here, the swapping will be processed by the two words. One is swap out and next one is swapping. Okay. So, for the swap out, we are having three different types of conditions. These conditions is also called as in scenarios. Okay. Again, I am defining this one. So, for performing the action of a swapping, we have to transfer the information from main memory to secondary memory and secondary memory to main memory as a mediator of CPU. So, while transferring the information between these two, we have to perform different conditions. These conditions will be taken as a swap-in condition and swap-out condition. For performance of swap out condition, so we need three main methods or three scenarios for performing of swap out condition, swap out function. Let us go, what is a swap out condition? Suppose if P1 completed its execution, means the operations which are executed in the CPU will be completed. Then this process transfers the information from main memory to secondary memory. Okay, here I am performing the operation which is called as a swap out function. Okay, so you may confuse what you mean by swap out. Means the swap out condition will be defined in three scenarios. Okay, what is the first scenario nothing but, first suppose if the processes which are present in the main memory, these process information given to CPU. In the CPU, the operation will be performed. The arithmetic and the logic operation will be performed. After performing operation, after successful performing of operation, this process information will be transferred to secondary memory. This transfer is called swap out function. Okay? After successful completion of process P1 by the CPU or process P2 by the CPU, then that output or that information will be stored in the secondary memory. That is called swap out function. What is the second condition? Among the three, first condition is successful completion transfer. The second condition is when the process is waiting for IO operation, hence there is no need to stay in the secondary memory. So the operating system transfers the process to secondary memory from main memory. That means here, as we know that the CPU does not execute IO operation. If any process sends the request to perform the IO operation to the CPU, then again in this case also the process will be transfers its information from main memory to secondary memory. Okay, so first condition is after successful execution. The second condition is if IO operation will be IO request is came to the CPU, then the CPU does not accept. In this case also the process will be transfers its information to main memory to secondary memory. That is also called as a swap out function. And the third one, what is the third condition is when one process tries to interrupt the other process. That means here for each and every process their own executions will be there. For example, assume that it performs addition, it performs subtraction, it performs multiplication, it performs division. There is no comparison between all each and every process. If one process trying to interrupt, to disturb the other process, but this process not able, that means here the process P3 not able to perform addition, subtraction or division. The process P4 not able to perform multiplication, subtraction, addition. Okay, it performs only division, it performs only multiplication. First suppose in this case if P3 want to interrupt the process P1, if P4 want to interrupt the process P2, the CPU never execute those process. In this case, these process will be transferred to secondary memory. While one process is interrupting the other process, then the operating system terminate that process and this process will be stored in the secondary memory. Because the process executes those operations, it cannot execute other process operation. In this case, if any disturbance created by any process, then immediately this operating system terminates that process and stores that information to secondary memory. This is the third case. Okay, if any interrupt will be takes place, then trap will be performed. Trapping is nothing but if interrupt will be takes place by one process to another process, then operating system transfers that interrupted process to secondary memory from main memory. That is the third condition for swap out. Okay, what are the three conditions? One is successful execution and second one is if IO operation will be happened to the CPU, then that process will be transferred to secondary memory because the CPU does not perform IO operation. Third one is if any interruptions will be takes place among the processes, then the operating system transfers that interrupted processes to secondary memory from main memory. That is called as a swap out conditions. Okay, now let us go what is a swap in condition. Swap in condition means It is happening from secondary memory to main memory. When the CPU is in free state, then the CPU is ready to execute its operation. Hence, when the CPU want to execute the process, then OS transfers the process from secondary memory to main memory. Okay. When that means always the CPU is in a busy state. So if the CPU is in idle state and if the CPU want to execute the operation, then if the CPU sends the request to the operating system to execute the program, then what the operating system do? Then the operating system do the verification of the processes in the secondary memory, and from this secondary memory process, this is transferred to main memory, and from this main memory, the data will be transferred to CPU for the execution. Okay. So here one thing, so always the execution of process information will be taken from main memory only for the execution CPU. There is no chance to transfer the information from secondary memory to CPU. Though whatever the information will be presented in the secondary memory, if you want to transfer, then this secondary memory transfers the information to main memory, and from this main memory data is transferred to CPU. This is called swapping function. Okay, simply if the data transmission or the process information transmission from main memory to secondary memory, that is swapping. The process information from secondary memory to main memory by the CPU request, that is called swapping function. Okay, this is about the swapping concept. Okay, finally I am remembering that, so always the content will be taken from main memory for the CPU process execution only. Okay, so in the secondary memory also the number of process will be there. Okay, so these processes are transferred from main memory itself only. Okay, whatever the process will be stored in the main memory, and the process will be transferred to secondary memory process by depending upon these three conditions. Okay, so thank you.